Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 19 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I am joined by Mr. Tim Hayden. Tim is the co-author of The Mobile Commerce Revolution, Business Success in a Wireless World. He's part social anthropologist, part strategic marketing executive. Tim studies communication behavior and how new media and mobility are reshaping all of business. He's also the president and co-managing partner of Brain Trust Partners, an executive consultancy helping busy leaders manage an evolving marketplace with common sense and strategic guidance. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Mr. Tim Hayden. All right. I have the distinct honor of being joined by none other than Mr. Tim Hayden. Tim is, definitely at the top of his craft in the eyes of a lot of people. He co-authored The Mobile Commerce Revolution with Mr. Tom Webster, works with Zigno Labs, and just has a LinkedIn a mile long. So, Tim, thank you so much for taking the time.
Well, Tim, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So the road to digital marketing professionally tends to be a winding one. So take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Sure. I mean, you know, when I first moved to Austin in 1999, I was a recruiter, and I was helping one of the digital companies here, Trilogy. I was helping them raid public accounting firms because they thought they were going to go public. And they would bring anyone who had filed an S-1, they would try to hire them to help some of the software companies they were starting to go public. That never happened, but about 3 months after that, I ended up starting my first agency, and that was NION Interactive. It was it was basically a web design shop and a macromedia house. And I got a chance to work with companies like ExxonMobil and companies like Dell, and providing solutions to them via CD-ROMs and via the web. And at that point, I just knew it was a whole new ball game, and I saw a great future in it. So that's really how it started.
Absolutely. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that shiny veneer sort of come off and like, okay, things just got real?
Well, and that's perfect, because that's actually the next thing in the next chapter in my life. And that is, when the dot-com bubble burst, I think it was around that time, anywhere from 2001 to 2003, that all of a sudden, I quite honestly was tired of being in a dark studio with a bunch of designers. Right. That's nothing to say anything mal or critical about designers, but it is to say that I, at that time, said, you know, we're in Austin, Texas. The sun shines 300 days a year here, and we need to do something different. And I found my lead creative director at the time, and we decided to build an experiential shop, event marketing. And we left to do that, and I guess that's really where, while we were doing that, all of a sudden we started producing events and seeing everybody had a phone in their hand, and we wanted to figure that out.
Right.
So it was just how the worm turns, as my granddad would say. You know, it was chasing a passion, and bam, something just fell in my lap while I was doing that in the mid 2000s.
How the worm turns. I like that. Never heard that before. I think I'm going to steal it. So thank you to your granddad.
Go right ahead.
I'll make sure I give credit twice, then it's mine. So speaking of how the worm turns, if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watched Doctor Who. what are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
You know, I would say take more risks. I would say, I mean, I've taken plenty of risks, and some of them have landed me in a lot of trouble, more financial trouble than anything else. But I would say, you know, there were times where I should have hired somebody that I didn't think I should have hired at the time. There are times where I should have, maybe invested a little bit more in something I was doing for a client that I didn't do because I was being stingy about margins. It's about making and taking risks. I mean, you make the risks, you understand what they are, you size them up, and you take them. And the other side about it is, I would say to my younger self, I'd say, stop being complacent. And I taught myself that over the years. If I would have started about 5 years earlier to stop waiting for the world to deliver something to me, to stop waiting for the client to call me or the prospective client to say yes, and start being more proactive in what I do and leaning forward into what I do, then I think I could have done that much more aggressively than I did when I was younger.
I feel that. Nothing like going out there and get it. So you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss are all chilling at the bar after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
You know, Gary V and I've had these conversations before, I've actually been somewhat tactfully critical with him. Tact sometimes flies out the window when you're dealing with him. But, specifically with that group of people, I would say, to answer your question, digital is not strictly something that's technologically driven. We have to understand that the future is a blend of analog and digital. And if there's anything that mobile has taught us, and, when I was at Edelman and I ran the mobile program there, I would many times start a mobile strategy talking about cocktail napkins, billboards, television, before I would even talk about a mobile app. Because let's understand, it's the human we're trying to reach, and it's not the screen we're trying to reach. So much of what I see digital marketers do today is they throw the baby out with the bathwater. They say things like newspapers are dead, print media is dead. They say that outdoor, out of home, direct mail, all these things that are part of the marketing continuum have failed to work. FM radio is all of a sudden a poor investment. I would just say, hey, we need to understand that for digital to really reach its full potential, we have to respect and we have to employ so many of the things in the analog media, the traditional media world, that got us to this point.
Absolutely right. And I love what you just said, because I live in Atlanta, and earlier in 2016, I had the opportunity to attend a training by Michael J. Becker from M. Cordis, and it was on mobile. And he said very much the same thing. It's starting with the human that's mobile, right? Not the screen, not the device. So you have to hone in on the mom picking her kid up from school, right, and going to soccer practice, or a lot of the things that you keyed in on. So, I think a lot of people would do well to remember that it's a person you're trying to reach and not a product. So I feel that 100%. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive in deeper with Mr. Tim Hayden. So stick with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. All right. So, Tim, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself. What's your take on the whole fake news backlash that Facebook got after the 2016 presidential election? Because at first, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off like, oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the results. And then when the actual numbers came out that fake news outperformed real news on Facebook, now he's talking about cracking down on Facebook and instituting some type of verification process, because I honestly don't quite know where I stand on the subject just yet. I could argue either side of the coin. I could go strictly First Amendment on you, like Facebook is a platform only. It's not really their place to try to impose, you know, what's true for people. But sure. I could also go the other way and say Facebook is a digital property, and as a property owner, be it terrestrial or digital, you are responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, you know, if you're at a speaking engagement or somewhere and you got a pool in your backyard and some knuckleheads kids decide they want to hop the fence and skinny dip in your pool and one of them drowns. You know, still responsible for what goes on your property. So I honestly don't know where I fall. So I'm just curious on your take on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is something that we at Brain Trust Partners we take a really close look at, and that is, I've quoted this a few times over the last several weeks. My good friend Neil Burns, who's with the University of San Francisco, prior to that he was with the University of Texas, and he ran the Center for Brand Research. Basically, he said something to me 4 or 5 years ago, and he said, Tim, I'm afraid we're at the point where people are beginning to believe what they think. And Facebook, as far as their role in all of this, Facebook, for its advertising to work as it does, to be hyper-targeted and personalized and giving you, the marketer, the ability to find people based on certain things they like and certain preferences they have, whether it's lifestyle or it's brand, whatever it may be, and who they're connected to, who influences them, the magic in Facebook marketing or advertising, those same rules, those same algorithms, as we like to just say it's just the algorithm, you know, that right there is actually what got us in the jam where people who only wanted to listen to certain media outlets and only wanted to follow certain people and to share certain content, Facebook learned to put more of that similar content in their feeds. And that's just the nature of the beast. Facebook has a responsibility here to make, if they're going to be a news source, they will have to, in some form or fashion, become responsible in an unbiased way in terms of how people get their news. That is a big part of it. I think there's a larger issue here, though, and this is what I think, where we just left off talking about humans instead of devices, is that humans will have to understand that they have a personal responsibility to go out and be diligent about the issues and the matters that are in their community. Right. And if their community is the United States, or their community is the globe, or their community is Atlanta or Austin, Texas, they are going to have to invest diligence, and they're going to have to listen to both sides of an argument. Doesn't mean that they have to agree and all of a sudden be Switzerland. They're going to have to understand that people have got opposing views, and through mediation, both formal and very informal, two guys talking in a bar, mm-hmm. I think we're going to find a way, and I hope to goodness I'm right when I say this, we're going to find a way to have a better way of communicating and having empathy with each other than just only listening to and hearing what we subscribe to, because that's the big jam we're in right now.
Right. You're absolutely right. And it's a pickle. It's a very complex issue because, to your point, I tell people all of the time, you know, Facebook has a responsibility, a fiduciary responsibility to make money for its investors. You can't be publicly traded and not make money. And they figured out how to do that. But the flip side to that coin is, like you said, they tend to serve up more of what people want as opposed to, you know, more even kill or unbiased information. So it's, I'm really curious to see how that all shakes out. So one last question, and I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate your time, but I am going to take just a moment to set the question up because I really want you to understand why it is I'm asking the question the way I'm asking it and what I'm trying to get from you, because every podcast is somebody's first podcast. So this last question, it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked, but I'm going in a particular direction. So in my personal opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a brand or agency or at a corporation. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 or 1099 at the end of the year. So just using my own journey as an analog, you start off sort of meandering the wilds of Google for a year or 10 or however long. You have some wins and you have some losses. And at some point you decide you want to get serious. And when you're at that jumping off point and you decide you want to get serious and turn pro, you kind of have two options. You can do what I did, which is go back to college and get a degree specific to internet marketing. The cons with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 from the U.S. Department of Education. Plus, even though the degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And 30 months in the digital space is a lifetime. A lot can happen in 30 months. But by far, the most common way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less expensive than going to college, you have to have that money up front. So take a South by Southwest or Marketing Profs B2B Forum or MozCon, something like that. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, food for however many days, Uber back and forth. Nope. Just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all those things back in, you're looking at between $3,000 to $5,000 on a single conference. And in my experience, some of these places, they have a VIP coaching program or some sort of mastermind that you can join, and those can be upwards of $10,000. So even though in aggregate, you know, 15, 20 grand is a lot less than 60 for a degree, you got to have that money up front. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to sort of crowdsource ideas. Okay, let's say you're at that jumping off point, you're ready to go pro, but you're done rolling the dice on Google. You might end up on lynda.com, you might end up in Amway, who knows? And you don't want to borrow a bunch of money from the Department of Education and have to sell them your firstborn child, but you also don't have the money up front for some of these conferences. So now that I've just sort of set up that hypothesis, here's the actual question. Imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You still have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, laptop, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
So I think, you know, I had the answer until you threw that last cherry on top about working for free. I still get to know everything that I knew before. I would go and I would start to look at what's available with sites like Convince and Convert and start to listen to a number of different podcasts And the people who appear on those podcasts, I'd find ways to reach out to them through LinkedIn, through Twitter. I probably wouldn't go to Facebook. I think Facebook is still primarily a place for friends. I think it's much easier, and it is on a professional note if you're going through LinkedIn to connect with somebody. And I think you need to be absolutely, or I would be, answering your question directly, I would be very transparent with anyone that I was reaching out to say, I don't want to take too much of your time. I know your time is valuable. I've got a couple of questions I'd like to ask you. And if you could share 15 minutes with me on the phone or via Skype, if all I have is a laptop, I would appreciate it. Thank you in advance. And I would probably use general sales numbers to say I've got to talk to 10 people to probably net 3 of those calls. I would just work it that way. But I would find a lot of what's available from a audio and visual video standpoint. I would find all the content that's out there free and available in sites like Convince and Convert. I just think that's, I'm not hanging my hat up there, but that is just such a wealth. I tell a lot of people that's the place. If you had only 5 minutes in the day that you could spend, if you did have a job and you wanted to start to learn how all this stuff works, that's probably one of the places I would invest my time to learn about it. But to your other point on who do I connect with, I'd probably look at Twitter. I don't care what people say about Twitter dying or that Twitter has lost its value. It's still an incredible place to find like-minded people or to find people that are in specific verticals or have specific skills that you want to follow and you want to learn from, both from the content they share and your ability to connect with them one-on-one. So that's my answer, and I'm sticking to it, especially if you're not paying me.
I dig it. I definitely dig it, because I'll tell anybody in a heartbeat, professionally speaking, Twitter is my favorite social network, like the end, bar none, because most of the people I've reached out to from a podcast and just later connected to on LinkedIn have started on Twitter, and I cannot co-sign enough what you said about Convince and Convert. I actually listen to 3 podcasts by Convince and Convert. I listen to Social Pros, I listen to Influence Pros, and I listen to the actual Convince and Convert podcast where they take the blog posts and transcribe them audibly. So can't knock none of that. So Tim, thank you so much for your time. I greatly appreciate it. Please take a moment and tell people how we can get some more of you, where to follow you on Twitter, etc. What you got going on at Zignal Labs, if you have any courses coming out, you know, where can we get some more of you?
Well, you got it. I mean, truth is, I've got an exciting new venture, Brain Trust Partners, that my business partners are Scott Monty, who ran global digital media at Ford Motor Company, Christopher Barger, who most recently was with Voce Communications, and before that ran global digital media at General Motors, Frank Eliason, who most recently was with Zeno Group, and before that was global customer experience, head of global customer experience for Citigroup, and then Angus Young, who for the last 3 years has been working with Jeremiah Owe and Crowd Companies. Obviously, with my background in mobile and in analytics, together, the things we're doing at braintrust.partners, that being the best place to find us, are all about digital transformation. So braintrust.partners is where you can find, I'm not going to call it thought leadership. I think it has to earn that label. But so much of what we're working on and so much of what our points of view may be can be found there. I'm always available and can be found every day at the Tim Hayden on Twitter. And those are really the two best places to find me and to find what it is and my merry band of partners are doing these days.
And just a quick quirk before we get out of here. Tim wrote a book called The Mobile Commerce Revolution with Tom Webster. And Tom Webster does a podcast with Mark Schaefer. And the intros to that podcast is done by his partner, Scott Monty. And they're really, really good. They're really funny. So in addition to Scott Monty's professional accolades, he's one hell of a voiceover artist as well. So yeah, man, this has been awesome. Tim, thanks so much. I do appreciate it.
You got it, Tim. Thanks, brother.
Thank you. Have a great day. If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.